The liberation of France during the Second World War happened relatively swift, but how did it exactly happen? Iconic are the D-Day landings, but then what? Was there a battle for Paris and the Allies only came in via the West? In this video, I'm going to talk about the liberation of France during the Second World War. Good to have you back on the channel, and if you're new, welcome to History Hustle. My name is Stefan, I'm a history teacher from the Netherlands, and I make videos about history for you. If you like that, please consider subscribing, and do not forget to hit that notification bell. On the 6th of June, 1944, the Allies undertook the biggest landing operation in history, Operation Overlord. This operation consisted of 175,000 men were about to set ashore on the beaches of Normandy, France. Around 80 kilometers of coastline was divided in five zones. Utah and Omaha for the Americans, Gold and Sword for the British, and Juneau for the Canadians. Canada was back then still part of the British Empire. Allied paratroopers were to be dropped behind enemy lines, and the French resistance took its part in sabotaging the French railway network. However, because of bad weather, the ship's naval guns, as well as aerial bombing planes, weren't able to destroy the obstacles from the beaches. Also, many Sherman tanks that were dropped near the beaches in the water didn't manage to get on land. At Utah Beach, the US 4th Infantry Division made it ashore with fewer than 200 deadly casualties and moved inland to link up with the paratroopers. On Omaha Beach, the attackers of the 1st and 29th Infantry Division had a very hard time. The Allied bombing had largely missed its targets, and therefore the Americans that set ashore at Omaha Beach were met by a hail of German machine gun bullets. Also, many landing crafts got stuck in the sand dunes, so therefore American troops had to hop out of their boats in order to make it ashore. Some of them drowned, and others were basically sitting ducks in the water, which severely slowed them down. Yet, one company managed to find a crack in the German defenses, and with help of naval guns as well. With the very few tanks that got ashore, they managed to break through. On Gold Beach, the British 50th Division managed to get ashore successfully without too much casualties. Their Canadian comrades of the Canadian 3rd Division had a much harder time on Juneau Beach. Here the Germans had fortified seaside villages and above all a network of tunnels. The British 3rd Division had a tough time as well on Sword Beach. This was because of the high tide, artillery fire, and the large German bunker complex that was located there. Yet, the 6th Airborne Division had managed to blow up the bridges in the hinterland that prevented German reinforcements. The Allies had now successfully managed to establish a bridgehead on Normandy. However, the battle for Normandy, let alone the battle for France, was far from over. German generals argued that if the Allies weren't pushed back into the sea, the battle would be lost. Cannes was a major city located near Sword Beach. Aerial bombing had largely flattened the city and also killed 300 French civilians. Because of this, the Germans were alerted and they moved in. Fighting for the Allies proved to be very difficult in the rubble of the city, and it took them over 1 month to capture Cannes. The 12th SS Panzer Division, Hitlerjugend, fought extremely fanatical. Its leaders said to its soldiers that those who surrendered showed signs of treachery, and therefore these men fought till the bitter end. Once captured, some of these fanatical SS members refused blood transfusions. They did not want foreign blood, and above all, they wanted to die for their Führer. So understand here that the whole assertion of the Allies only encountering low morale Germans simply is not true. Further west, the Allies fought for Contentin, Cherbourg, and Saint-Lô. Do understand that however the Germans there were outnumbered, they proved to be a tough opponent because some of these men had experience from the Eastern Front. Rommel and Rundstedt asked Hitler on 17 June for permission to withdraw their forces to a more defensible line behind the River Orne and beyond the range of Allied naval guns. Hitler, on a brief visit to France to impose his will on his generals, refused to consider anything of the sort. It was this manic obstinacy and interference in command decisions which decided not just the pattern of the Normandy campaign, but the fate of the whole of France. Over the course of the summer, the Germans managed to keep the Allies stuck at Normandy with the bulk of their panzer units. At the end of July 1944, the Allies launched Operation Cobra, which proved successful because they broke out of Normandy. Also, at that time, the Germans encountered a severe defeat at the Eastern Front during Operation Bagration. Because of this breakthrough, the German 7th Army became surrounded at Falaise. This pocket held out for over a week. When it was dissolved, the road to Paris laid open. On August 19th, Free French Commander Charles de Gaulle met with Supreme Commander Eisenhower. De Gaulle insisted to march on Paris as soon as possible. The French resistance was already planning an uprising. De Gaulle was afraid that the communists among them would take power, so he wanted to move in with his forces to prevent that from happening. The Paris insurrection had already started. German commander Dietrich von Schultitsch was ordered by Hitler to destroy the city, but he lacked the will nor the means to do so. Severe skirmishes between Germans and French resistance took place for several days. On August 25th, the Allies entered the city. Paris was spared from total destruction. The French resistance sprung up after the French defeat of 1940, where the French commander Charles de Gaulle encouraged the French to resist against its occupier. Resistance varied from spreading anti-German newspapers, broadcasting radio programs, as well as armed resistance like assassination attempts. The resistance members came from different classes of French society and had different ideologies. Some supported de Gaulle, others were communists or anarchists. Yet they were united by one goal. They were supplied and sometimes trained by the British and American intelligence services. After the Normandy breakout, they helped liberating town after town and took a substantial role in the liberation of Paris. In the meanwhile, Polish, Free French and Dutch forces were set ashore on Normandy to help with the liberation of Western Europe. The advance after the Normandy breakout went so swift that the Allies ran into supply problems. For this, they set up the Red Ball Express, which was a truck convoy system to supply their advance. And another aspect that attributed to the swift liberation of France was Operation Dragoon. An operation that is not very well known is Operation Dragoon, which was launched mid-August. Over 150,000 Allied soldiers landed on the Côte d'Azur between Marseille and Nice. It speeded up the German retreat from France. It therefore also limited the damage in France, although this of course did not apply for the cities and towns in Normandy. Many of these were reduced to ashes. Although France was liberated in 1944, some German pockets held out till 1944 on the Atlantic coastline. There were German fortified places that held out till May 1945. Having liberated France so quickly, the Allies believed that Belgium, Luxembourg, and the Netherlands were for the taking. But they were wrong. Because in December 1944, the Germans launched the Ardennes Offensive. I'm gonna talk about that in the next video. Subscribe so you don't miss out. thanks to my patrons you see on screen, and a special thanks to Henry Clarkson, Michael Nozak, and Wombat Cookie. If you want to support me, please go to the link in the description. And do check me out on Patreon, because with your donations, I can make better, cooler, and more awesome content for you. If you want to know more about why the Germans held out till the bitter end, you can click right here. Merci pour watching et au revoir.